So one of the cool things about a smartphone is that what's displayed on the screen of the phone changes in response to how I orient the phone. So for example, if I take a phone in the portrait mode and rotate it such that comes in the landscape mode, the display changes accordingly, or what's on the screen changes accordingly. And this is enabled by this fascinating piece of technology, which is the MEMS accelerometer. So if I open up this phone and look under the hood on the printed circuit board, there are a plethora of sensors on this PCB of this particular iPhone, and I want to call out three of them, which are responsible for what is called as motion sensing on this phone. The first one is the accelerometer, which essentially what it does, it measures the acceleration, which includes the force, which includes the acceleration due to force of gravity along these three axes, and hence it's a three-axis accelerometer. The other one is this IC over here, which is the gyroscope. And what it does, it measures the angular rotation along these three axes, which is often referred by these terms pitch, roll, and yaw, which we'll talk more about when we talk about gyroscopes in the subsequent videos. And the third one is this magnetometer, or the compass. Okay, many times you might see these terms called as six-axis motion sensor, or six-axis IMU, where IMU stands for inertial motion or inertial measurement unit. Okay, so don't get daunted. You know what they're essentially saying by the six-axis IMU is that it's combining this three-axis data from the accelerometer along with this three axis of data from the gyroscope, and they're using it in conjunction, or using both of these data sets to enable better motion sensing than what you would get from using any of these sensors individually. And again, sometimes you might even read terms like nine-axis IMUs, which again means that they're combining this another three axes of data from this magnetic compass, and this magnetic compass might be useful, very useful in the case where you have application which involve navigation. Similarly, the data from the gyroscope and the accelerometer would be very useful for apps which involve gaming. And what it means is that you're using data from multiple of these sensors which are involved with the motion sensing. Okay, so that was an application of MEMS accelerometer in a consumer electronics. A much older application where MEMS sensors have been prevalent are in our cars, and shown over here is a MEMS accelerometer, which is especially very helpful regarding the deployment of airbags. So let's say you were driving along in this direction and suddenly you had an accident, or you hit something, and that would result in a very large negative acceleration along this direction. And again, the MEMS accelerometer would come to a rescue and detect this very large acceleration, negative acceleration, and accordingly deploy airbag, which would prevent you from, in this case, hitting the wheel of the car and injuring yourself. Similarly, if there was another, if your car was going in this direction and another automobile comes and hits you in from the side, okay? So again, this accelerometer would detect that acceleration in another direction. And hopefully you have a car which has side airbags. So again, it would deploy these side airbags, which would prevent you from hitting the door or the side of your car. Okay, so I'm very fascinated by how do these things work. Okay, So let's talk a little bit about the basics of MEMS accelerometer. And these accelerometer either detect the change in capacitance or they detect the change in resistance. Majority of the market is dominated by these accelerometer which measure the change in capacitance. So the operating principle is very similar to what you have in mass attached to a spring. Okay, so we are all familiar with this problem from our high school. So whenever you have acceleration or a force acting on this spring, the length of the spring changes or it expands or it contracts depending upon this force. So the very same concept is in play over here. What you have in this MEMS system is that you have a miniature version of this spring, and you have a mass, and it's often also referred to as the proof mass, or sometimes it's also referred to as the seismic mass. And it's usually confined to move along a certain direction. In this case, it's confined to move, let's say, along the x direction. Okay, so how do you convert that into capacitance? Okay, so what you have typically are this proof mass or the seismic mass. It would have a fin structure like this, and then you would have these other plates which are fixed while this mass is moving, and then you measure the capacitance, okay, between this mass and this fixed outer plate. Okay, so let's say the distance between these two plates when this mass was at rest or when there was no acceleration was denoted by this distance d. And then this mass moved by this distance x in response to the acceleration that was acting upon this proof mass. Okay, so we can figure out that one of these capacitance will increase and the other one will decrease. So what is often measured is the difference between these two capacitance C1 and C2. So C1 could be denoted by, it would be proportional of course to the area that this capacitor has, and it would be inversely proportional to this distance. So in this case, C1 would essentially respond as this, while C2, which is the capacitance with respect to the other fin, would behave something like this. And you can prove that the difference in the capacitance, it's proportional to, of course, the area, and it's proportional to the amount that this proof mass moves, and it has this relationship with D. Okay, so if we want to sense essentially a larger capacitance delta, it's advisable that the amount that this proof mass or the seismic mass moves is large as well. Okay, the other equation which is in play over here is related to this spring, and this is again an equation that I'm sure you're all familiar from your high school physics. That is the spring equation or the Hooke's law. So the displacement that this proof mass experiences is proportional to, again, the force, which is proportional to the mass times the acceleration, okay, given by this Hooke's law or this spring equation. So again, you can express this displacement as a function of the acceleration, the mass of this proof mass, and the stiffness constant of the spring, which is denoted by K over here. Okay, so we can express this by using this resonant frequency as well. where this resonant frequency would be given by this formula that, again, you might be familiar from your high school physics. So a few things to point out over here. The first is that, let's say I want to measure a very small amount of acceleration. So again, if I want to sense a certain amount of capacitance difference, I want this x to be large. So I want essentially this proof mass to be large in value, or I want the mass of this proof mass to be large, especially if I want to measure accelerations which are small in nature. The other thing which is related to this resonant frequency is that it's proportional to the stiffness constant and inversely proportional to the mass, okay? So usually if you have a high resonant frequency, or if you want to measure this sample, the data from this accelerometer at a high frequency, what that would usually mean is that this displacement would be less because your resonant frequency is high. So your capacitance, it has to be very sensitive to a small amount of change in this capacitance. One of the way that you can actually increase this capacitance is by increasing this area, so which is shown in this picture over here, right? So many a times what you would do to maximize this change in capacitance is design your system in such a way that you have a lot of area which increases your capacitance. So you would have this comb-like structure, okay? And then you would have multitude of plates inside it, okay? So that way you maximize the area that you have with this fixed plates, okay? So all these blue plates would be connected to each other. Similarly, all these pink plates would be connected to each other. And one of them would be responsible for measuring C1, and the other one would be responsible for measuring this C2, okay? So shown in action in this picture is this proof mass over here, right? Let me use the same color. So shown here is this proof mass, and again you can see it has multiple of these fins, okay, to trying to maximize this delta C, and it has these fixed plates, okay, which are all connected. These blue plates are all connected with each other. Similarly, you have these pink plates over here, okay, and these would be all also connected to each other. So you're maximizing the capacitance that you're measuring, and you're maximizing the delta between them, okay? So then one question that you may ask is, okay, so this is for measuring the capacitance along, let's say, x-axis. How do I measure the acceleration along the y-axis? So that might be simple, you know, with not stretching your imagination too much. You can think of another proof mass which is oriented along this perpendicular direction, okay? And again, associated with this, you would have a set of plates, fixed plates, which again measure these capacitances. And that would give you acceleration not just along the x-axis, but also along the y-axis. Another way you can achieve that two-axis accelerometer is shown over here. So in this design, you only have one proof mass. Okay, so this is your proof mass, but it's anchored in such a way that it can move in both x and y direction. Okay, and it would have a set of plates over here. okay, and a set of fins over here. And when this proof mass experiences the acceleration along x direction, these set of fins and these set of fixed plates shown over here would detect that capacitance change. And it also has another set of plates which are perpendicular and another set of fins which are perpendicular over here, which would measure the change in capacitance and the acceleration in the y direction. So this is a design which accomplishes two-axis sensing of acceleration using just one proof mass. So now, how would I make a three-axis accelerometer? Let's talk about that in the next video.